Today is August 22nd, 1996. I'm conducting an interview with Johanna Kimmel Goldberg, maiden name Schmiedel. I'm Yvonne Walter, and this is San Francisco, California, United States of America. The language is English. My name is Yvonne Walter. Today is August 22nd, 1996. I'm conducting an interview with Johanna Kimmel Goldberg in San Francisco, California, United States of America. The language is English. Good morning. Would you please state and spell your name?
Johanna Kimmel Goldberg.
Would you please spell your name?
Should I spell it? J-O-H-A-N-N-A K-I-M-E-L G-O-L-D-B-E-R-G.
What was your name at birth?
Schmiedel. S-S-C-H-M-I-E-D-L.
What is your birth date?
May 31st, 1912.
And how old are you today?
84.
Where were you born?
I was born in Vienna.
Would you tell me a little about your childhood, about your parents?
Gladly. I had a very protected childhood. My parents were wealthy. My mother was one in this time, a liberated woman, a very rare thing, because before she married, she went to a school where they teach women to make money professionally. And that was very rare because in this time, women had only to be mothers and housewives.
Do you remember the name of the school and where it was?
Yes, it was Frauenerwerbsverein. I'm sorry, it's German and it's very hard to translate it. It's very hard to translate. My father comes from a wealthy family. They had a ranch and sawmills out of Vienna. The town is called Pöchlarn an der Donau, and it is near the monastery of Melk, M-E-L-K. And my father went to school there because it was the only gymnasium in the neighborhood. And there were three sons, and they sent him in summer with a carriage and in winter with Schlitten, with
sled,
yeah. And that was it. And I had a very nice childhood, very protected. We made trips. I remember we spent every spring and autumn on the Riviera. And in the meantime, in the time in between, as it was usual, you made the cure in different spas. And in one evening when my mother went to Karlsbad, I met my future husband years later. And my father was not very happy with him because my father was a proud Viennese man, and to marry a German subject was the last thing in the world. And he said there's only one explanation. When you met him, the revolving door of the hotel, he was thrown to your head, and this really explains everything.
What was your father's name?
My father was Richard Joseph Schmiedel.
And could you describe a little bit more about his work?
Yes. He was partly a vice president of the Donaudampfschifffahrtsgesellschaft, and then later he left his office and was buying plots and built houses and sold them, and I think he made nice money with it.
Could you say
one house he never sold, and this house is a very funny thing. He hasn't sold it because the roof was finished on the day of my birth. And Vienna, when a roof is finished, there's a big party, and it was exactly the date of my birth. So he never sold this house, and I fought for this house later, after the war, because it was stolen of my mother.
What about your mother and her work?
My mother was what being a housewife, she opened a big store for shoes, as my father was anyway a silent companion in a few shoes factories. So it worked all perfect together. I went to elementary school, and I had the first experience with anti-Semitism, because when I was 8 years old, I had a very dangerous surgery, what is called a prenatal fibroid. Should I try to translate it? No. And in this time, of course, a surgery like this was much more difficult than today. And this was a very dangerous point, so my head was fixed here the whole time of the surgery in some blockage in a machine that I couldn't move, because the tiniest movement would be dangerous. So I was already healthy, and I went to school, and I was here still blue. And one day, my teacher, I still remember her name, Margarete Liebl, she said, I was 8 years old, oh, our nice Hansi Schmiedel my pet name was Hansi, has forgotten to wash her neck today. And I started to cry, and I was running home. My father took my hand and said, we arrange it. He went immediately to the headmaster of the school and said, what do you think about it? He said, no, it's awful, I'm devastated. But would Hansi be satisfied when the teacher makes an apology in front of the class? I cried, I didn't answer. My father said, yes, you would, and that was done. And from this time, the teacher behaved marvelous. That was the elementary school. And then when I was 10, I entered a very well-known gymnasium in Vienna. It is one of the most severe schools, and it is only for girls. And I had, for instance, Latin every day for 8 years.
Would you name that school, please?
Yes, it is Albertgasse 38, Reformerei Gymnasium. And as I wanted to explain, I had Latin every day, because my father insisted, when you have a true knowledge of Latin, you understand a lot. And that's true, even a lot of English words have origins in Latin. And still today, I know Latin poetry by heart. You never forget a thing like that when you have it every day 8 years. And in the last vacation, I went with my mother to one of the spas that I mentioned before, Karlsbad. And in the hotel where we lived a man from Germany with his mother, who accompanied his mother to the spa, and that was my future husband. And I finished school, and my father was very, very angry that he called every day from Berlin. He said, my daughter is still a schoolgirl, it's awful, this only a German could do a thing like that, you see. And it's very sad that a Viennese girl couldn't find a boyfriend in Vienna. She had to import one, so he was mad. Anyway,
can we go back just a little bit about some of your earlier experiences in Vienna as far as your Jewish identity, the Shabbat, if you celebrated
that? I tell you, I lived in a very assimilated household. So I had no Jewish connection. I was later a Girl Scout in a Zionistic movement. But my parents really didn't live as Jews. I still remember when we had a time for Christmas, my father said to his bookkeeper, I want the same amount for the Social Democrats, for the Christian Socialists, and for the Jews. So, I mean, I had really no Jewish experience whatsoever. In the school, I knew I was Jewish, and I even was in some way very attracted to a lot of things, about marriage, not influenced by my parents.
What kind of things attracted you?
The stories, for instance. I loved the Pesach story, and I loved the Purim story, what a young girl would like, you see. But my parents had no idea what it is about. My mother had a faint idea, my husband, my father, not at all.
What about some of your friends?
We had mostly Gentile friends, not Jewish friends.
Can you describe some of your hobbies or extracurricular lessons as a child?
As a child? I was always making sketches. I was so good at drawing. I liked to swim. And that's it. And what a young girl doesn't. And I even liked school. And we had a lot of sport at school, obligatory, skiing and skating, and I always joined it. It was very nice.
How was Vienna at your time toward the Jews before the war?
I think that you didn't mention that you are Jewish. No one asked you. And for myself, I can say I knew I was Jewish, but I was never proud and never ashamed of it. It was quite natural, you know.
Had you brothers and sisters?
No, I'm an only child. I had only dogs always because I was brought up with dogs, and I spent vacations on the ranch of my grandparents. So they have horses and dogs and cats. And it was very funny in the home of my grandparents where every Saturday night chamber music and the animals were allowed to be present. The animals only were not permitted to go to the dining room, as my grandfather said, as long as they are not using cutlery. They don't go to the dining room. And I loved being there. These were beautiful surroundings. Even Brahms was a friend of my grandfather, and he came sometimes to concerts and said he could feel at home. They named his one of the cats Clara. And you know why? Because his love was Clara von Schumann. Clara Schumann was the love of Brahms. And I said to the cook, what a funny name, Clara, for a cat. Why? She said, a child has not to ask questions. That was it, and it was really a lovely childhood.
Can you tell me how many years you went to school?
After the elementary school, 8 years. And then I graduated and got immediately married and immediately pregnant.
Could you tell me a little about the name of your husband and what he did?
Yes. My husband was a freelance journalist. And my father said, the condition is that you live in Vienna with my daughter. I don't give permission that she goes to Germany. What will you do for a living? My husband said, you will see. And my father said, I have to tell you, my daughter's a poor girl. She doesn't get any dowry, not one shilling. He said, I'm sorry, I haven't asked you. That's okay with me. And I got as a wedding gift a beautiful villa, completed with carpets and silver and china, whatever one needs. Fully furnished, of course. But my father insisted it's everything on my name. So there was some pre-marriage agreement made at the notary that whatever's in the house is only property of Hansi. That's it. And my husband said he didn't mind. As long as you let me sleep in your bed, it's okay. And that was it. And then I got married on the 9th of November, 30.
And how old were you?
18. And my father had a funny idea. He said, only nouveau riche takes her daughter to the synagogue. I don't do it. And he ordered from Schönbrunn, from the castle, the carriages with Lipizzaner, I'm so sorry that all these photos got lost during moving and emigrating, because we had lovely photos, how these Lipizzanas, you know, have seen them possibly here too, with the carriages took me to the synagogue.
How was it for you at synagogue?
Pardon me?
How was a synagogue service for you since you grew up without?
Normally. Only one thing I insisted. In Vienna, it was used when the bride comes in to play Traulich geführt, do you know? From Richard, that's a melody of Richard Wagner. And I insisted I don't want it. It looks, it's for me to say it. I insisted on the Hertikva. And it was a very new idea, and I think the rabbi didn't like it. But I was stubborn, and I said, it's my wedding, and I want to be happy on my wedding day. And so the Hatikva was played.
Do you remember the name of the synagogue?
Yes, it was Klukigasse. No, and this is not like here, that the synagogues have names. It is only where they are located.
How did you pursue your Jewish life after you got married?
I tell you, my husband came really from a religious home, yeah? But we had a normal household, not kosher, because I told you I was a stubborn girl, and I said possibly I'm wrong, but I don't see a connection between soul and digestion. And I think the laws were hygienic laws, and say, today is a situation, another one. And we didn't fight about it. We lived a very comfortable house life. After 9 months, my daughter was born. We had a nurse for the child, and we had a cook and a girl to make the rooms. So I think till Hitler came, I was not rinsing a teacup. My mother used to say, don't go in the kitchen air, the smell goes in the hair. You never get rid of it. Don't. So I didn't. But anyway, I like to eat, and I always do till now. And then when you like to eat, you are interested in cooking. So I bought cookbooks, you see, as a young wife, and I got the cook of my mother. So I said, you see, I come to the kitchen, and I watch you, but don't tell mother. And so I really learned nicely to cook and to bake.
Could you tell me a little about your husband's work and what happened to him?
Yes. He worked later only for German publicity firms, and he worked very successful.
And what happened during the years you were married, 1930?
That was from 30, I say, till 38. In the meantime, 31, my father passed away. And as we had really a large villa with a guest room, we decided mother should live with us. So she lived with us. It was really sometimes harmonic, sometimes not, like it is with a mother-in-law and a son-in-law. But it worked out in the end. And one, could I continue now already for Nazi Germany, Nazi Austria? When Hitler invaded Austria, I had a feeling the world is falling apart. From one day to the other, in the windows of the apartments, the picture of Schuschnigg were taken out and the pictures of Hitler were put in. And I was so disgusted. But I knew already, I met a few Austrians and politicians, and I knew that the Austrians were not flexible in their political opinion. They were always firm for one party, for the majority. And that explains everything. And that explains how quickly they agreed to Hitler, because they saw as possibly a prosperity coming, and the majority was for Hitler. And we really didn't know how it will work out. It was also unclear. And my mother said it will not last long, because the Völkerbund, do you know what that means, wouldn't agree to it. So Hitler would have to leave. It can't go on. He's a stranger. No, no. Said, don't be nervous, she talked to me. Everything will be all right. Our life wouldn't be changed.
What year was that?
1938, when Hitler came to Austria. But we met a few acquaintances, and everyone said to emigrate. And for instance, my mother had a very beautiful property, and Eddie Elter, who was a friend of hers, says, you know, I have an offer of America. You could change this property for a big property in Long Island. And because you couldn't take money out anyway, but this could be still done. So my mother said, I shall think it over. And she spoke with family and with other people. And she said, you know, everyone told me, what should I do, say, in America with the natives? Because she had a very primitive idea that it is not Vienna. Anyway, the life went on, and one day she watched, my husband was with his car, drive in, yes? And some uniformed man took him away with the car. She watched it from a window, and she told me, and I said, well, possibly it's some information they want. You know how it is nowadays. He said, well, he will come back. And he didn't come back in one day, in 2 days. He didn't come back in 1 week. And we didn't know where he is and what happened to him. And after 1 week, I went to the Geheime Staatspolizei in Vienna and said, you know, my husband was taken away from our drive-in with his car. What happened to him? He said, we sent him on a vacation. And that was it. Let's say approximately 2 weeks later, I got a card from my husband. I'm in Dachau, in the concentration camp. And I can write one postcard a month. And you can send me every month, I don't remember, it was 12 or 15 shillings, a bagatelle, yeah? But this own sentence, monthly, convinced me it wouldn't be a longer stay. It wouldn't be that they sent him home immediately. And I thought what I should do, and I really had no idea what to do. My husband had a cousin, and this cousin was in this time the managing director of the Palestine Amt in Berlin. So I said, do you know, to my mother, you stay here, and I go to Berlin, and I speak with Alfred. In his position, he would know what to do. So I went to Berlin, and he had really a position. He was on good terms with the Nazi regime because he was the managing director for immigration to Palestine. So he said, darling, you can't do anything. Now is Lagersperre. Hard to translate. The camp is closed. And no one can go out. So you can't do anything. He said, now what would you expect me to do? He said, take your daughter and go to Palestine. Palestine was our only possibility. I really wanted to go to the States. But the quota for Vienna was very bad. That means we had to wait 3 years. In 3 years, you could be a few times dead already. So, and in Palestine, you could not come in legally. But if you had a capitalist certificate, we couldn't have it because in the moment everything was blocked. The bank account was blocked. And I was only allowed to take a certain amount out for living, yeah? But the brother of this Palestina Amt manager was a very famous gynecologist in Israel, a professor, and he made a deposit at the government of Palestine for £1,000 in the name of my husband and me, and we got a capitalist certificate, and I was informed my certificate lies in the Palestina Amt and British Consulate in Geneva. So, but it didn't help me. So he said, you take your daughter and go to Palestine. And he said, I asked him, and who would take care of Bob? His nickname, pet name was Bob. He said, God will help, God will know. I had all confidence in God, you see. But it was really no, I wouldn't say a date. So I thought, what should I do? And I lived with the aunt of my husband. And she wanted to relax me. She said, we think it over. Today I take you to a coffee shop in the Kurfürstendamm. And I buy you a nice cake. So we went to this coffee shop, and on the adjoining table, I saw three guys in the conversation, and they mentioned a few things about Dachau and Gestapo and hope. And you see, I was 26, so very young, and I got up, and I said, I beg your pardon. I would say bad times rectify bad manners. I was hearing what you are saying. My husband is in Dachau. Could you help? And one guy, an elderly guy, gave me his card, yeah? And he said, not here. Come tomorrow to this office, 4:00. And he stopped speaking with me. So I went home with my aunt, and I said, tomorrow I shall see. And I went there, and he told me, see, I can't give you much hope, and I can't help, and I don't charge you because I don't do anything for you. I can only tell you, there is one guy in the Geheime Staatspolizei, an old count, his room number, I guess, is 760 or something, I don't remember the number now. And if you are successful to see him and to convince him, possibly you have hope.
So
oh, I see. Hand. I shouldn't touch.
You had your hand over the mic.
Yeah, I see.
Would you please continue?
So I went the next day, and when I came to the Gestapo, there was a big sign, no Jews, entry forbidden. But I went through, and I saw a nice fat guy, and I always have the idea fat guys are easier to handle. And I spoke to him in Viennese, in a very Viennese dialect, and I said, I came to see this and this guy. I came extra from Vienna. And he thought, in his stupid mind, I was sent from Vienna to the Geheime Staatspolizei to see this man. So he said, all right, we are nearly Landsleute, we are nearly, I'm from Munich and Vienna, that's really very near. So I take you to him. So he took me to him. And this guy, he said, gnädige Frau, and offered me a sheet, what is on your mind? And I told him. And you see, in some way, I was really innocent. I didn't still believe the Nazi mentality. And I said, you see, Germany is a Rechtsstaat. I don't think they care for justice. I don't think you keep a man who is innocent in jail. My husband had no love affair with a Gentile girl. Yeah? He paid his taxes. And then he said, I think he even didn't have a parking ticket. And it was very stupid. But anyway, this guy started to laugh. Yeah? And he said, now I tell you, I asked for his papers from Vienna, and you come in 2 days, and I give you an answer. All right, I thanked him very much. After 2 days, I went there, and as he said, whatever you told me is true. I can only confirm it, and what I can do to help you, I would do. Come tomorrow. And so I came for a whole week, every day, and he always said, come tomorrow. And this cousin of my husband, he said, I told you, it's hopeless, yeah? Don't believe it. Perhaps he liked conversation with you, yeah? I said, no, I trust him. I have a good feeling with this guy. But I lost my nerves. And I made a very crazy thing. I made a phone call to the Palestine Amt in Geneva, and I knew the man. He was a Bundesbruder of my husband, a Dr. Schöps. And I said, send me a fake telegram. Certificate only valid till this and this date, let's see, 3-4 days, yeah? A little bit more, perhaps 1.5 week, yeah? And this idea could have been for my family, death or concentration camp. Sent me a fake telegram, yeah? I got this telegram, and I went to my friend in the Gestapo, and I said to him, you see, even in these bad times, I have a possibility to speak with a human being like you. But the British people are bureaucrats, you see. My visa is canceled when I don't come. He said, do you know that the whole act of your husband is finished? I need only the signature of Himmler. And this I get today. I would advise you, today is Friday, yeah? Take the train to Munich, the night train, yeah? And you will get your husband tomorrow by the Geheime Staatspolizei. I thanked him very much and I left. And I told this, my cousin, yeah, this man from the Palestine Amt, he said, I can't explain how sorry I am for you. This guy makes fun of you. What are you doing? I said, I take the train and do it. He said, I tell you what, I have a friend, an attorney. He will go with you in Munich. I tell him to go to the station and pick you up. How will you recognize me? I said, I describe you, your size and how you look. What will you wear? I said, a blue suit, blue hat. All right. So I arrived in Munich, and this guy was already here. And he said, I spoke with Alfred. I go with you to the Geheime Staatspolizei. I don't believe 1 minute you get your husband. But we do it. So we went there, he went with me, and they said, Schutzhäftling Kimmel, yes, we sent him to Buchenwald today. Buchenwald is another concentration camp near Weimar. So you see, he said to me, what will you do now? I said, I called my guy in Berlin. I said, how could you dare, a Jewish woman, to call a man in the Geheime Staatspolizei? I said, I have to do it. I feel it's a force in me. I can't go home, yeah? So I called, and this man was on the phone, and he said, I waited your call because you think I make fun of you, huh? No. You take the night train to Weimar, and your husband will be free tomorrow from Buchenwald. The attorney was hearing the conversation. He said, he sounds sincere, but I have to tell you another thing. First is Lagersperre. Second, tomorrow is Sunday. Have you ever heard that something happens in Germany on a Sunday? Except church service. So I said, anyway, I have to go. So he took me to the station, and his wife and he, they put, I remember, I took wagon lit, they put chocolates on my pillowcase for a sweet sleep. And I arrived in Weimar at 7 o'clock in the morning, and I took a cab to the Geheime Staatspolizei, and they were very friendly. I felt already better. I had a feeling they thought that the imprisonment of my husband was an error or something, because the guy said, sit down, have a cup of coffee. It's too early to go to Buchenwald. Yeah? You can't go before 8 o'clock. So at 8 o'clock, I took a cab, and I came to Buchenwald, and I came. I tell you, the drive was the most beautiful thing, because the landscape is so beautiful, and it was autumn, and the trees were in all colors of red. And even in my mood, I saw it, and I said, one has to, well, this has to be painted, how it looks. And it looks as the forest grew darker and darker. And then we came to the camp, and then I saw my husband. And he looked awful. His suit was torn. His eye was swollen. His nose was swollen. And his suit was bloody and torn. And I had to sign a receipt that I got him alive. And this I signed. And I took him to Weimar. In the first hotel, I made him a bath and ordered him a meal. And then said, listen, perhaps you lay down and they'll go out and buy you a suit, you feel better. And don't tell me, I don't want to hear anything. And he said, I can't speak anyway. He was in an awful state. So I went out and bought him a suit, and when I came back, what are we doing now? I said, now you have to go out of Germany immediately. And I will see that you go to Geneva, yeah? And I shall go to Vienna and see how I can liquidate and take Helga. And we meet in Geneva and we go together. I have already a booking on a boat. Do you have your passport? No. Where's your passport? My passport is still in Dachau. That was a very serious handicap, very serious. So I said, all right, we go to Munich. I called the attorney, who was so nice to go with me, and he took my husband in his house. And he took my husband, it was Rosh Hashanah. He took my husband to the synagogue, and he gave him all the honors, you see. I don't know enough to tell you what he had to say, but he took him to the Torah and he said, a miracle has happened. A living man came out of the death of hell, and we have to give him all the honors we can give. And there is something special, I really don't know what he did. Reading the Torah, I would say a prayer, I can't tell you, because I really have not the name and I don't know what was it. Anyway, my husband stayed in the home of this attorney, and I was traveling to Munich to go to Dachau for his passport, because without a passport there was nothing to do. So I went to Munich and I went to Dachau and asked for his passport. And they put me in some observation tower to wait. And I tell you, I was in such a mood, I turned my back to the window. I didn't want to see anything. And after 2 hours, he came and brought me, it was the worst 2 hours in my life. They brought me the passport, and still, this is German order, I think 7 shillings that he had still on his account. So I took the passport and went back to Munich, yeah? And I said to his attorney, I even would like to take him tonight out of Germany, yeah? And I'll go back to Vienna. And we decided the best thing would be to go to Basel, that's Bale, because Bale has in the railway station two exits. One is Switzerland and one is Germany. Have you heard about this? So I took him to Bale, and I still remember he went, when we were on the streets, he went along there, the walls of the buildings. You see, he was so scared. And I brought him to the Palestine Amt and said to care of him and put him in a hotel, and I went back to Vienna. And I had already advertised for the house to sell. And there was one man and his wife who fell in love with the house immediately. And I don't remember how much I asked for the house, let's say 100,000 shillings. I don't remember. And he was not bargaining with me. He said, that is exactly the sum that I got as dowry for my wife, and I wanted to invest, and it's perfect, and we fell in love with the house. So in this time to sell, it has to go to a certain office, it was called Vermögensverkehrsstelle, to make the transfer of Jewish property to some Aryan buyer. This guy, he wasn't blacklisted, but he was a little bit suspicious because he was a monarchist, you know. This means more or less an enemy of the Nazis. So anyway, we went both together to this office, and they said, yes, yes, we approve of the sale. No, we were already glad to hear it, yeah? But I tell you, this Jewish woman gets 30% less from the price you agreed. So we went down the stairs, we both signed. And we went down the stairs, and his name was Aston. So he said, when we were going down, now you think this Aston swine, these pigs, he arranged it nicely that you get less. But I tell you before what I told you, I give you, and I give the 30% black on under the table. So you have some black money. That was for this man very dangerous, and for me very dangerous to accept, and for him to give. Anyway, 2 days later he got a letter. The sale of the house is finally approved, and the price is $130,000. That means $30,000 more than he agreed first. So there was no idea that he gave me anything, because he had to make a loan from his father-in-law for the $30,000. They didn't have the money. Anyway, he got the house. And this man did everything what he could to be helpful, risking his life. He was driving me around the last errands and everything, you see, because I got permission to take the furniture that was very costly and the carpets out of the country. No money. I got the allowance to get the value of three English pounds approximately, cash, yeah? And I could pay from the money of the building, I could pay the travel expense, that was it. And he was driving me around, you know, there are a lot of errands to do, and when he brought me to the station, and went to with my daughter to go out, to leave my homeland. I cried a little bit, he cried, and I said, really, Herr Regierungsrat, I don't know how to thank you, how you behaved. And he said, I can tell you what you can do. When you are out of this hell, you say there are still honest people in Austria. And tell them you met an honest man. And that was my last word with him. And in connection with this conversation, years later, after the war, you had an opportunity to make sales under pressure not valid and get everything back. And you knew I have not got money for my house. What I got was, a tip, yeah? So I wrote to him and I said, Herr Regierungsrat, you can sleep quiet. I don't ask my house back. And that is my thank you, how you behaved. And I said, keep this letter. That is very important for you, even for Entnazifizierung. And he did. That was years, years later. And when I came to Vienna later, I came to Vienna the first time, I guess, 51.
Can we go back just a little bit after you left and your last words with this gentleman?
With this gentleman, I left, and I met my husband. I went to Switzerland, and I met my husband. And from there, we went to Trieste, and we took the boat to Palestine. And Sukkot, that you mean how quick it was, because I told you, Rosh Hashanah was really his life-saving journey, yeah? In Sukkot, we arrived in Israel.
1938.
Yeah. We arrived in Jaffa, and there was his brother and two brothers and family and his mother, and we were all very happy. My husband was still in a situation he couldn't have one real serious thought, one reaction to reality. He really couldn't believe he's free. So anyway, we came to Palestine, and now came the newest problem, what are we doing? He had a very religious brother who took us in the first days, and ultra-Orthodox. And you could imagine, I had no idea from everything, when he was yelling at me that I was put the electricity on Friday night to clean my teeth. He was yelling, and I wear shorts, of course. It was awfully hot, and I had the same figure I have today. I have always the same weight. I was slim, and I was wearing shorts. And he said to my husband, no Jewish women should wear this shameless outfit of your wife. Anyway, he was looking, you see, and I had a feeling he enjoyed what he sees. But he said, no Jewish woman should do it. So I spoke with my mother-in-law. She adored me. She was my guest in Vienna a few times, and she has always told me, one hair of you is more valuable to me than all my children. She really loved me. So I said, Oma Clara, what are we doing? I can't stay here. You know, he drives me crazy. I can't. And my child couldn't understand his yelling all about, because she has no idea either. So anyway, she said, I have an idea. In Vienna, you were knitting so beautifully, yeah? Here is wool, the most beautiful wool, and no one knows how to do it. I have spoken with a Russian woman she's bored with her housekeeping, and she would invest something and make with you a knitting parlor. And you will give instructions and finish the things, and she gives you a guarantee for living. So I met this woman. The difficulty was, I didn't speak Hebrew and not Russian, and our common language was French. So we communicated, and she said she will invest 20 Palestinian pounds, and she offers me a guarantee of £6 a month. With £6, I could have my rent paid and what I need, living expenses. And I insisted even, that was my European background, I don't want this little girl playing on the streets like all the girls. I need someone to take care of her, what you will call a Kindermädchen. So we arranged this, and I found an apartment in the best neighborhood of Tel Aviv, opposite today Grand Hotel Dan, the best neighborhood. And I practically was a perfectionist, and I wanted only the best. And this had a beautiful terrace, and I thought, here the women will knit. And it worked perfectly well. It was a big success. The problem, how will you explain the women what to do? You have 1 week here. You don't speak Hebrew, of course. So I asked this French woman to tell me exactly what I need to deduct stitches, to add stitches, the colors and the numbers. And all this I put down in writing and learned it like a parrot, you see. And when these women came for instructions and I spoke to them and told them in Hebrew, they said, this woman is a miracle. She's 1 week here and she speaks Hebrew, and these people were very proud Zionists, you see, in Palestine. When they would ask me what day is today or what's your name, I wouldn't have given an answer. I wouldn't know. But as a parrot, it worked perfectly well. Years later, when I was already wealthy, I learned Hebrew because I was fascinated with the language. But this worked perfectly well a couple of years. But I was in all this time only half a person because my mother was still in Vienna. And I knew an old woman. You see, today, 72, not old. I'm 84 and I don't feel old. But in this time, over 70, you thought a very old woman, and she was sickly. And I spoke with everyone, and this cousin who arranged the certificate for us, yeah, was married with a Sabra. A Sabra is a woman born in Israel that comes, when I compare it, like Mayflower, peer Americans, yeah? And she knew a lot of people, and her cousin was Sharet, that is, he was later foreign minister in Israel, yeah? And she introduced me, and he said, I tell you, there's one person who can help, that is a high commissioner, and he doesn't want to see any people. He's a very strange man. But a friend of mine is playing bridge with him, and he will take you to Jerusalem and introduce you. So he did it, and I saw the high commissioner, and he was very friendly, and he looked at me politely and interested, and I told him, I want my mother. He said, were you not informed? There are no parent certificates. No, decidedly not 2 years. Imagine, it was before the war. One thought the war can break out every day, huh? So what should I say? He said, I'm very sorry, my answer is no. And he was looking me over, you see, and I was sitting with crossed legs, and I had very good legs, and I always knew how to use them. But I was in this time not in a flirtatious mood, but I felt his eyes on my legs, you see. And he said with a very ugly smile, you know, we are not interested really in putting old ladies. And I was jumping up. I'm a very controlled person, but as I'm Gemini, there are two persons in me. I was jumping up. And I said, listen, perhaps you have a mother, or perhaps you had one once. You ought to be ashamed. And he was looking at me, and he said, come down. Is there an emergency for your mother? I will help. And I invented a story on the spur of the moment that a gardener made a denunciation at the Gestapo that my mother is the aunt of the Guslov murder, Frankfurter. That was a man who was shot in Paris, yeah, by a Jewish guy from Vienna. And I knew the story because the uncle of this guy was our rabbi, yeah? So, and I knew he was already in Dachau. And I said, this guy said, my mother is the aunt, but I can raise my hand, the story is not true. Only I meant another thing, and he meant another thing. Anyway, my mother got the certificate the next day. That is the second miracle I told you. And my mother arrived on her birthday, on the 2nd April, on Erev Pesach. That was a second miracle. And my mother helped me with the child and with the household, and I could work. My husband was still not very good at work. But shortly before the war broke out, we were lucky. Our lift arrived from Vienna with the furniture. With the furniture, and he took, he found someone with money, an attorney, and he opened some storage place, and there came all our furniture in, and we sold our complete household. Whatever there was very costly furniture, antique furniture, and the most beautiful carpets, and we sold everything. And that started, you see, that gave us some money, and we felt a little bit more secure, and we needed money because, this is, speak of furniture, the only piece I kept, because it was from my grandmother. That was the only piece, and everything else was sold. In the
came out of his depression. Would you please continue?
So our furniture was slowly sold out, and I can tell you from this moment on, I have no feeling for collecting as I was collecting in Vienna. What you see here, I feel like camping, because whatever I brought to America of good things, I left my daughter. We bought a property together in San Rafael, and I left it to her. I have no feeling anymore for furniture, for antiques, because I remember how I left them and how I sold them because I was forced to do. And what the feeling I got now is for animals, for cats, for dogs, and for plants, for living things. Anyway, so my husband had worked out to sell our furniture, and in the meantime, a lot of other immigrants came to the country, and they had to sell too. So my husband took furniture and carpets from other people on consignment, and this worked very well, and we had a little bit of income because it came handy. My income was very slowly going down. There was no wool more. No, you see, the wool in Palestine came from France and Germany. And as the war broke out, France and Germany were occupied with other things, as in sending wool to Palestine. And there was no wool anymore. But we thought, what are we doing now? Because even the things that my husband got on consignment came to an end. There came no boats with furniture anymore, so everything was stopped, and we were standing again for a very serious decision. And I had an idea. In one of the main streets of Tel Aviv, that would be compared to market like it was 20 years ago, yeah? Not the market of the street of today. And there was a store in the best neighborhood who sold typewriters, and he had a typewriter, one typewriter, and a big showcase. And I met this guy at a party. And I said to him, Klaus, you are really a fool. You have one typewriter in a big showcase. You pay a girl to take your orders. He lived mostly of repairs, yeah? So you have one girl there who take orders by telephone, yeah? such a foolish idea. I give you an offer. I pay half your rent. You give me your showcase, and I take your orders, and you don't need the girl. He said, could you start tomorrow? I said, oh, not tomorrow, but on Monday. So I got a beautiful place. Now he asked me, what would you sell? I said, I have an idea. In Israel, that means it was still Palestine, there is the habit whenever you are invited, you never come with empty hands. And whatever you bring, a piece of chocolate or a book or flowers, it's like a price stamp on it, yeah? I would like to open a store for matanot. That means little gifts, yeah? And I will have different things. And I think I will make bookkeeping what sells best. And after 2 months, I will make this what only sells best. And so I started, and it was very hard to find merchandise, yes? But I had a few pounds from the sale of our furniture and our household goods. And I really started this business. And I decorated nicely, and I took his orders, and he was very glad and very content that it worked out so nice. And I found out after 2 months what sell best is bijoux. Some a necklace or a pin or a pair of earrings. Much better. The hostess was more, I see, glad to get it than a box of chocolate. So how do you get these things? And now the war has started. There was nothing to buy. And as I had a hobby as a girl, I made always necklaces. So I went to Bethlehem, and I found an old Arab who was very nice, and I told him what I want to do. And I said, I would like to buy rosaries, all kinds of rosaries, yeah? And I will make necklaces out of it. Do you mind? He said, no, business is business. He had no religious, no idea that he's again. First of all, he was no Christian. Anyway, I bought a few rosaries, different things, and I bought some kind of grains, you see. I don't know, in German it's Johannesbrot, how would you say? They are brown sticks. I don't know what you call it in English. You don't know either. Anyway, I bought different grains, and I made necklaces of rosaries and of grains for sporty dresses. They looked very nice, and they sold perfect. And after a few months, I decided only to have bijouterie, and I started to manufacture. And this was really the beginning of our wealth in Israel. I left this guy because I needed a bigger showcase, and I opened a store opposite, yes? And I even made in the newspaper a competition. We pay, I think, £200 for someone for a good name, and the name came out Bijou. So the store was Bijou, and it worked very well. On the second place in the store, my husband worked. My husband was an excellent salesman. If there would be a story to sell me a beer in Munich, he would do it. So he sold his necklaces and earrings because I had no patience. And you see, when a woman came in and said, what earrings should I wear? What should I wear to pants? I would be angry and say a mustache. You see, I really had no patience for this. And in this time, on another party, I met a guy of the Foreign Trade Institute in Israel, yeah, in Palestine. And he said, I know your stores and don't know what you are doing. Make a collection for export. And I did it. And he introduced me. You see, the same trouble we had, all the neighboring Arab countries had. They got no merchandise. That was exactly the same trouble. There were no boats coming with anything. So he introduced me to buyers from Tehran, from Baghdad, from Cairo. And I got beautiful orders. and it worked perfectly well because for me it was interesting. I found in the retail shop what is the taste of the people. I was still new in the country, yes, but I saw what sells, and this I made in the collection for abroad. And the director of the Palestine Export Institute, he told me, do you know, in all my practice, I see the first time that Arabs send blanco checks, like they're sending to you, and leave it to you to choose merchandise. And we are very happy with you. So, and he said, and I'm with you. It's likewise. So anyway, it worked nicely. And said a retail shop worked, and my husband was a good sales guy. And so we made a very nice living. Now comes a funny story too. I always wanted to go to Egypt. And a Jewish woman from Palestine couldn't get an entry visa. And I was sorry for one thing. It was a very big department store in Cairo, Sukirel. It is like in Paris, Galerie Lafayette or something. And they were my biggest clients. And they were even Jews, and she couldn't help me for a visa. And we had a friend who came every Saturday to ask for breakfast because his wife didn't want him to make crumbs on the carpet when there is no maid in. So he came to ask for breakfast. And during breakfast, he said, you know, in next month, I have a very interesting tip, journey. The Palestine Philatelisten Corporation is invited by King Farouk. And we are 14 men going, and I'm really looking forward. And I said, and you know, we will go 14 men and one woman. He said, how come? You can't. You are not a member. I said, Walter, it's not your first lie and not your last. You will say, I'm a member for 2 years. And so I got my entry visa to Egypt and went with them to Egypt. And it was not only interesting concerning my profession in any other way too. I spent days in the Egyptian Museum and I found out that the necklaces Nofretete were wearing were similar to the things that I did. And we never met. We have never met. So anyway, I was very happy in Cairo. And one day, King Farouk invited us to a party. He went every night with his suite, with his followers, to a nightclub, Oberche Pyramid. And he made a very smart decision for a king. He bought the place. So we thought the money he's spending comes to him back again. So anyway, there was a reception, and I was introduced, and he said, do you know, it's funny that a young, attractive woman is collecting stamps. I think at your age you have other hobbies. So I said, you know, one hobby doesn't exclude other hobbies. One can make different things. So anyway, he said, how come that you are interested in stamps? I said, I inherited from my father a very valuable collection, and he had special pieces. He said, tell me, what pieces did he have, the special? And I had as much idea of stamps, I don't know. I had no idea at all. And I said, you know, it's very hard for me to speak about it. My father said, when you speak about it, there comes the evil eye. And he said, oh, stop it, don't speak one word. I believe in evil eyes. And so I was saved because I had no idea from every valuable piece. Anyway, it was a lovely party. In the end, he kissed my hand. And I thought, I'm the only Jewish woman of Palestine whose hand was kissed by King Farouk. And this is a story of the Egyptian trip that was. We went later to Luxor, and it was really very, very interesting. The business went very well. I sold to all places. I had customers in Persia and in all the Arabs. They were forced to buy because nothing came in. And there were war and there were parties, yeah, and so women want to dress normally. And I was again on a bitter end, so rosaries were bought out. I got no material. I didn't know what to do. What would I do for necklaces? I made a lot of filigree jewelry in silver, and I made the designs. I was a very good designer, and it worked very well. Only I sold even to America. The disadvantage is, even I made on millimeter paper, exact sketches, it was hard for the Yemenites to do it. But the Yemenites are like artists, you know. They have to add a personal note. And the American buyers didn't understand. There are slight differences. And I wasn't in America anyway, but I explained by letter. The artists, they can't do exactly the same, even if they have the sketches. There are slight differences. That was the one part of what we exported, but what really the big business was the Arab countries, and I had no material. So in Israel now comes, and you will really laugh, in Israel is a big factory of noodles and macaroni, and they made different shapes, round things and like shells, and bows, and I went to this factory, and I said, what are you doing with all these materials that's got rotten when Israel, a hot climate, when you have worms in it and it's rotten? He said, I throw it away. I said, what would you give it to me? I said, I buy it. What will you do with it? I said, I make a try. I can't tell you how much I need. Give me a few days and make a try. I took a big bag with different designs, and I went to Rehovot. Rehovot is the Institute for Research, yeah?
Weizmann Institute.
Weizmann Institute, yes. And I said, could you help me? Could you impregnate these noodles that they don't break and that no worms come in? What do you want to do with it? I said, jewelry. The guy thought I'm nuts. But he said, possibly, I've seen a lot of nutty women, but I shall oblige. And he found out what he could do. And I took these prepared noodles, and I found a very nice German Kunstgewerblerin. That means she is not really an artist, you see, half an artist. And I told her what I wanted. I wanted, for instance, the noodles that were like shells, painted from ivory to a light pink in all shades, and we made beautiful necklaces. And I went to the Foreign Trade Institute with a collection of noodles, and they said, oh, the nourishing collection. and we got orders on and on, because the people in Egypt, in Baghdad, wherever, they were parties, and they were poor, and the woman had nothing to wear, and they bought the thing. They were not very expensive, you see, because the noodles I got for nothing. I had only to pay the work for rearranging it, yes, and make necklaces, and of course what I want to gain, but I didn't do it for pleasure only. So it worked very well. And this worked really till the end of the war. And after the war, things came in and we manufactured things there.
Can I go back just a little bit? How did you perceive the end of the war? How did you know the war was over?
No, there was a radio, yeah. We were hearing, there was no television or yet, but we were hearing radio every moment. And there was already the idea that there will be Palestine in the newspapers, yes? Israel in the newspapers, that will be a Jewish state. And there's a very touching thing. My mother was what you would call Victorian. She was very unhappy in Israel because for after her opinion, there must be a special potato for a potato salad. And she couldn't get it. And she told me, imagine where I bought coffee, he didn't wash his hands and before he served herring to a woman. And she was so disgusted. And she said, you know, the first boat that goes, I go back. And then came in the newspapers the stories, there will be a Jewish state, and there will be Jewish milice, Jewish soldiers and the Jewish army and Jewish police. And she was awfully excited. And she said, do you know, when these poor prosecuted people get all this, I stay. And she kept her word. She passed away a few months later. The state of Israel was declared and she passed away a few months later. So she kept her word. What else would you like to know?
How was it in Israel after the state in 1948? We're speaking of 1948, is that?
Yes, I was still in the same business, yeah? And I thought, well, I need things from abroad. So I went to Paris and I went to Austria and I bought merchandise, yeah? And I imported it and it was very hard because you couldn't import as much as you wanted and there was heavy duty on it, yeah? But here again, God blessed me, I had an idea. I said to the people, I had this business in Austria and a very honest woman were hiding materials in Austria. So I have still the materials, they are my property, they are in a cellar, may I bring it? Sure, and you wouldn't pay duty, it wouldn't pay duty because it's yours, yeah? So I, but give me a proof. No, what proof could I give him? I went to a printing press and ordered old letters, Mrs. and Mr. Kimmel, who was a zeb and bijouterie export, import. That was very easy. That was my proof. I couldn't give him any other proof. But he was satisfied. And so I brought a lot of merchandise and I sold it with a very nice scale in the store and in the retail store. And it worked very well. So, and on the other hand, in the meantime, Ben-Gurion had arranged with Adenauer some arrangement for refund of, Wiedergutmachung.
Restitution.
So, restitution. So my husband got money from Germany and we had money saved. And I had in the meantime, against the will of my husband, he was in this time in the hospital, bought a plot out of Tel Aviv. And I bought for it 50 pounds. I didn't have the pound. I had 10 and I bought it from friends and said I will pay it back and what I did later. And my husband was very mad and he said, only a woman can buy a plot where that you can't reach. There is no road goes there. And where have you bought it? I saw it on a map in the bank. Only a woman could do such nonsense. The nonsense came out later that for the 50 English pounds, it was a value later of 100,000 Palestinian pounds. So it was the best neighborhood. My neighbor was being Diane and Golda Meir. I told you, I always go for the best neighborhood.
What was the neighborhood?
Pardon me?
What was the name of the neighborhood?
This is called University Quarters. And we had this plot, but I always liked flowers and gardens, and I wanted to live outside of Tel Aviv. But of course, we had no money to buy or build a house. And anyway, it was after the war. You couldn't buy anything. You couldn't get a refrigerator. You couldn't get a stove, nothing. And not for love and not for money. It wasn't there, yeah? So I saw an advertising in the Jerusalem Post from the Argentine consul. He had brought for his sister-in-law a California custom-built trailer, yeah? And the police didn't allow him to put it on where he wanted it, and he has to sell. And I was looking at it, and he said, I thought my dream coming true. A gas stove, a refrigerator, air conditioned, beautiful furniture. It was 9 meters long, the longest thing I've ever seen. And I said to the consul, how much is it? And he gave a price I knew I could afford it. And I said, all right, I come with my husband. And my husband saw it, and he said, over my dead body. I don't live, I'm not a gypsy. I don't live anything like that. I said, I don't think you should live. I think as a weekend we should use it. We have a nice apartment in San Francisco, in Tel Aviv. But for the weekend it would lovely. No, no, no. My answer is no. So I spoke with the Argentine consul and I said, would you give me 1 month to convince my husband? He said, sure, 1 month is not the end of the world. After 1 month, I said to my husband, I tell you one thing, I don't want to fight with you, but I paid in advance this consul a sum. If you don't want it, we forget it. We lost already money under Hitler. We lose again. What could happen? I don't want that our marriage suffers about, I don't know which how much I told him I had paid. He said, if you paid already, take it. That's nonsense. So we took it. He was the proudest owner later because we lived there and it was very, only weekends or vacation. It was a drive from, let's say, from our store, 20 minutes. It was later one of the best neighborhoods, what I told you. So we had this trailer, and after a couple of years again, when money came from Germany regularly, we had the idea to build there a house. And we sold the trailer, and the trailer had still a future. An archaeological company bought it and took it to the desert, and we made on the same plot a house. This house, as my father built houses, I was used to read plans, yes? Before I could read, I understand a plan for a house, yes? So I made a plan what I really wanted, and we made a beautiful home there. And as my husband and I suffered very much from the climate of the heat, we had sold already the store, and we were always 6 months in Europe, in Berlin, in Germany, or in Switzerland, or in Austria, and had rented the house in the meantime to consulates. And from the rent, we could live perfect in Europe, you see. The rent was very high because it was a good neighborhood and it's beautiful furnished, and everyone liked it. So there was no trouble, and we made a living in Europe very comfortable. And I think 65, we were always from May till end of September in Europe. In May, I think 65, we were in Baden-Baden, and I met my second husband. Both my husbands were gamblers, but they gambled on different tables. And I was looking over...
You were still married to your first husband.
Yeah, Bobby?
You were still married.
Of course. And I was looking at another guy, and I was some way attracted, yes? And he said, let's dinner together, my wife and your husband. And so we had dinner together, and the next time lunch together. And we spent a couple of days together. And after 3 or 4 days, he told me, do you know, I've thought things over. You have nothing in common with your husband. I have nothing in common with my wife. Let's get married.
We'll talk about how you left Israel and married this wonderful Mr.
So I told him, you're nuts. You are married, I'm married. You know, he said, you've never heard of divorce? So I said, yes, I've heard about it, but I'm not ready yet. Think it over. I tell you, he said, he was a very interesting guy, very good looking. I am a Capricorn. I get always what I want. Sometimes it takes time, but I get you too. I tell you. So anyway, we separated. I went with my husband to Israel, and he went to America. And he made phone calls to Israel, and he said, I kept my word, I separated already from my wife. How far are you? I said, I have done nothing. First of all, my husband is against divorce. And after Jewish law, when a husband says no, it's no. So I said, we think about it. I was not too keen. He was 24 years older than I was. So I thought 24 years is, even in old age, a very, very big difference, yes? I had felt already with my first husband that 14 years were a lot. But we were still young. But this guy, even when he was 24 years older, you had not an impression that he's a very old man. Anyway, I lived in Israel and went to Europe, and this doctor had a beautiful baritone voice because in Berlin he was a treating doctor of Caruso.
What was his name?
My husband, Leopold Goldberg. And now I go, speaking of Goldberg, I go mostly under Kimmel. Do you know why? In America, when I say Goldberg, everyone say, are you related to Whoopi? And then I have always to say only my name. And so I say mostly my name is Kimmel. So anyway, he sent me his records to Israel or to Switzerland, wherever I was, this Dr. Goldberg. And my husband was very angry. He said, this stupid old guy of San Francisco, he doesn't give up. I said, what does it hurt you? We are still married, what do you want? So we were listening to the voice. He had a beautiful voice. Do you want a few tones? Would that be nice?
Yes.
Sure. Yeah? I could do it possibly. Said you hear he could sing. I don't think without my glasses, I don't see. He could sing in French, in Italian, in German, whatever you want. No, why doesn't it work? You tell me where to stop. Volume. Wait one moment. I have to explain. This is without the gadgets of today. That was recorded when he was already a very old man, and I think he was nearly 85 when he was singing this, but it was without the gadgets and a very bad, how should I say, he never spent money on himself. I think he took the cheapest place to have it recorded, and so it sounds. And so we lived our separate life. And 79, my husband passed away. 79 or 78? My calculator here, I think, needs a battery is recharged.
78,
yeah. He knew from other friends, my husband passed away, so he sent me immediately an air ticket to San Francisco, and I sent it immediately back. And he said, was I too early? I said, yes, you were too early. And when I come to San Francisco, I don't want any obligation. I come on my own ticket, and that's it. And 1 year later, I went really to San Francisco. I have to tell you, I knew San Francisco. I had a trip around the world 52. And I fell in love with San Francisco, not in connection with Leopold Goldberg, I haven't met him, but I liked San Francisco. And I said, I'm coming back in old age. And I kept my word. So anyway, I sent him the picture back, his ticket back. And in the meantime, my daughter had a beautiful condominium in Rome. And beautiful, a penthouse, very, very expensive. And she really spent half a year, or only 3 months possibly there. So she came and she said, do you know, we are both lonely cats. You have here this house that you practically use half a year. I use Rome 3 months. Let's sell and we buy some property together in America, because I think the American dollar will be the last currency that will be changed to rubles. She still thought. I'm sorry. She still thought that Russia will the power once. Now her opinion is very, very changed. Anyway, we both decided to sell, and I came to America really to have a look if I would like to live here for good. And so I met Dr. Goldberg again, and I was still attracted, but I said, I don't want to get married, you see. You are so much older than I am. Let's live together and let's see. He said, no, I don't live in sin. Anyway, I didn't marry him so quick. I found a place in San Rafael that my daughter and I liked, a very large house in a very good neighborhood, and we decided to buy it, and I said, I go to Israel to liquidate and you liquidate in Rome. That we did, and we both did, and I came back to America, and we lived in this house together in San Rafael. I had brought furniture that I had, good ones, and she brought furniture, and the house was beautifully furnished. And I had with her an agreement, we lived together, yeah? And it, you see, my daughter and I, we have only an age difference of 19 years, so that is not another generation, so we both thought it would work out. And it didn't work out. First of all, she went to Paris, and I was in this large building with 4 bedrooms, 4 bathrooms, you have no idea. I felt lonely, and every night came the deer down. We had in the backyard, a mountain and swimming pool. The deer came down and we had a sensible insurance, and the insurance went on and the sheriff came every night, and it was like in an old Hollywood movie. Yeah? I couldn't sleep anymore. And I said to her, that is out for me. I can't do it. It takes my nerves because when you live here, yeah, it's all right. But you live in Paris and give me orders what to do. And then come another thing. We had some financial trouble. She has not brought everything what she promised, and I had it, you see. So practically all my, what I had was in this building, and there were troubles. And Leopold Goldberg came to visit us, and he said, your mother doesn't want to get married, what should I do? She said, that's your problem, you do what what you want. He said, but your mother is nervous. She has all her money invested in this house. You know it. She said, yes, you could help her out. You are a wealthy man. He said, no, I mentioned her in my last will anyway. Oh, she said, I thought it was a very tactless remark, so you give her something what you don't use anymore anyway. But he loved it. He liked it very much. He said he liked her too, and she says what she thinks. Anyway, I was not very happy in San Rafael, and I took my dog and my suitcases, and I went to San Francisco. And I stayed with him, and we said we'd try it out, but he influenced me, and we got married. And I'm sorry for every day that I have not married him before, because he was a very interesting man, even when he was an old man, and I was not bored in his company one moment. And he was the most easygoing, adoring husband, because I still remember, you see, my first husband took everything what I did for granted, and he was grateful for everything. When we said good night, he would say every day, good night, Liebchen. Liebchen is so like darling, yeah? Good night, I thank you for a beautiful day. And this gives a lot to a woman. And even when he fell sick, the last year was very difficult. I had it in three nursing homes, and in three nursing homes, I couldn't see how he was treated. And I spoke with his treating doctor and said, I take Leopold out. He said, you can't do it. I said, what do you mean I can't do it? He's 100 years old. He was already 100, yeah? No, nearly 100, I'll say, a few months less. He said, I don't speak for him. You can't do it. You wouldn't be able to do it. I said, I tell you something. The last nursing home is not the bed, not the worst. I pay his room and make an agreement that he can come back. I pay the room, yeah? Only the room. That is not the end of the world. And I shall try how it works at home. Oh, he said, Johanna, you are quite a lady. And I took him home, and I had three nurses, and a woman took for cleaning, because it's very bad that I'm married to a cook, but I'm not married to a house cleaner. This would be the worst thing. So anyway, he gained weight, and he was perfect at home. And he celebrated here in the building his 100th birthday, and he insisted on music, live music. And it was beautiful, and I tell you, he was the most vain person I know. He made a dress rehearsal with the nurses if he should wear a tie or a turtleneck. And in the end, he said, we let Mrs. decide, and we had a beautiful birthday. And he passed away approximately 6 weeks, 1 month after his birthday.
Can we talk about the Shoah or the Holocaust again? It's 50 years after the Shoah. Do you think about it often?
I was very often in Germany after this, and very often in Austria. It's hard to say. The people that you are meeting now are mostly children of or grandchildren of people who were there, really the devils in the Holocaust. You don't meet them. And what I thought most disgusting, when they are so very humble, you see? Do you understand what I mean? That is worse than the contrary. But I can't say, I have a feeling there's still anti-Semitism, of course, more in Austria than perhaps in Germany. You feel it more. I was reading in a newspaper in Austria, there was a question of 100 people, would you shake hands with a Jew? And 80 said no. That is a very sad sign still. But I hope still You see, I have letters from Austria, yeah? I will show it to you later. Well, they offered me a small sum, yeah? As a kind of, not Wiedergutmachung, because they say we can't repay the sorrow that we brought to you, the loss of health, the loss of your homeland, but the loss of personal relationship, we can't, of property. But we try here, this is a brief letter of the government, we try to make a bridge. Be helpful. That is the answer, but one tries, you see. Possibly there are, as I met in one honest person, perhaps there are more, perhaps they regret, I don't know.
In conclusion, Mrs. Goldberg, is there any message you'd like to leave for your children or for future generations?
You mean in America?
Anywhere in the world, about Holocaust, about survival.
Try the aller best. It shouldn't happen again.
I want to thank you very much, Mrs. Goldberg.
The pleasure was mine. I wouldn't say it was a pleasure, because you see, the pictures are coming back, and I hope I shall sleep tonight.
Now that we've come to the end of our interview, I'd like you to present us with some photographs and documents.
I introduce you to my mother, Charlotte Schmiedel, geboren in Deutsch, the liberated woman, I'll explain, and who was so very Victorian and changed her mind and was very happy to be in Israel.
How old was your mother here?
My mother, when she passed away, was 78.
And in this picture, how old is your mother?
Pardon me?
How old is your mother in this photograph?
Approximately 76. This is Richard Joseph Schmiedel, a proud Austrian, a proud Viennese citizen. And this is a picture during the war. He was an Austrian soldier.
Which war, Mrs. Goldberg?
He died, passed away. 31.
Which war was this?
They say First World War. He passed away 31. This is my first husband, Ignaz Bob Kimmel.
Where and when was this photo taken?
This was made in Berlin when we were nearly engaged, so he sent me this picture. That was 1930. This was my daughter at the age of 3.
Where was it?
This was done in Vienna. And this is my daughter today. Her name is Helga. She's born October 31, and she lives in Paris.
And this is your daughter?
Pardon me?
This is your daughter?
Yeah, and this is my daughter. This is me, Christmas 29. I was very proud. I got my first fur coat. I was 17 years old. This is me, 38. When I left Vienna. That was before the emigration, my last photo in Vienna. In this time I had black hair, and in Israel on my 50th birthday, I decided suddenly, whenever I look in the mirror, it's dark. Now I'm a blonde. And so I changed my hair. My father, top left in the Austrian army. He was a very good-looking man, and the women were always running after him.
What is the date on this picture, please? Do you know what date it is?
It was during the war. You see, I was I'm born 12, and the war was started 14. I can't tell you very much about it.
And you'll tell us.
This is my second husband, Leopold Goldberg, on the day when we decided to get married.
What date?
I don't know the date. I don't know. I remember when we got married, it was 4th of August, 81, but I don't know exactly the date when this picture was taken. This is from different trips my husband and I made. He was a very attractive man, even when he was 90. And we made, I remember one trip, we went to Lake Chapala in Mexico on continued education, and there were only doctors. And they said to him, listen, Leopold, are you not jealous? Your wife is so much younger and attractive, and everyone is flirting with her. He said, I would never have wanted a wife that no one else wants. This is a birth certificate of my daughter, Helga.
Date.
In Vienna, October 15, 31. This is the Entlassungsschein. That means the released forms of the concentration camp in Buchenwald when I got him back. It was September 38, I guess. This is my birth certificate. I was born May 31st, 1912, in Vienna. That's a marriage certificate from Vienna when I met my, when I married my first husband.
His name?
November 9th, 30.
And his name? Your husband?
Ignaz Bob Kimmel. The letters of the Nationalfonds der Republik Österreichs für Opfer des Nationalsozialismus. And they offered me an amount of 70,000 shilling. That is approximately $6,000. And they say, they know perfectly well that this small amount is no equivalent for that what I suffered, and they don't think it is a Wiedergutmachung, as you say in German.
Restitution.
It's only, it can't take out the sorrow and the loss of a homeland, the loss of a health, the loss of a whole life. These are letters of admission of the Austrian government, what they really did to the Jews. They say the hope, with a small amount they are sending, they can let us forget what we suffered in the darkest moments of German history. This third letter is the same thing, more or less. And they hope, with a small amount, to make a bridge between the Jews and the Austrian government, because they say they know what they did, and they are awfully sorry, and they know that saying sorry doesn't help a little bit. This is an interview that was taken of my, from my husband, from the San Francisco Chronicle or Examiner, I don't know, for outstanding citizens of San Francisco.
What is his name?
This is my husband, Leopold Goldberg, MD. This is in memoriam of my late husband from the CMA, the California Medical Association. Leopold Goldberg believed to be the oldest practicing doctor in San Francisco. When he retired at age 95, died of pneumonia, he was 100 years old. A native of Posen, Germany, he was the 13th child of poor parents. Possessed of a fine baritone voice, he earned enough singing in cafes and small operas companies to enter the University of Berlin. Years later, Enrico Caruso, a patient, urged him to forget medicine for the opera. Dr. Goldberg earned his medical degree in 1919 at Heidelberg, where he later taught. He was later invited in Heidelberg University because he was the only living person who graduated and lectured there. During the war, he served in the German army as a medical officer and was decorated with the Iron Cross first class. He practiced in Berlin until 1937, when he fled Germany to escape the regime of Adolf Hitler. Arriving in San Francisco, he faced the enormous problem of finding an internship in order to become licensed. Fortunately, a local doctor, W.B. Coffrey, recognized Dr. Goldberg as one of his lecturers in Heidelberg and got him an intern position at Southern Pacific Hospital at the prevailing rate of $15 per month. Once licensed, Dr. Goldberg divided his time between private offices in San Francisco and Stockton. At age 65, when most workers are considering retirement, he went to Europe for 18 months, postgraduate training in geriatrics medicine, returned to the city to practice his specialty for another 25 years. Poldi was a remarkable man in the Renaissance sense, both as a physician and as an ever-interested observer of humanity. He drove his own car until 96. He remained an encyclopedia instead in medicine, music, opera, cultural events, travel, and the world's affair until his final illness. He is survived by his wife, Johanna, and his daughter, Dolly Roberts, who share the society's sorrow.